Well, hidey-ho there again, boys and girls, and welcome to yet another edition of Live from the Tape Farm. Today we are going to be doing another guitar unboxing video, although we won't actually be doing any unboxing. I got the guitar delivered late yesterday afternoon, and I wanted to get the strings under tension and let it sit overnight, you know, stretch the strings, do all the normal stuff you do when you get a guitar out of the box, and then just kind of let it sit under tension before we started doing any in-depth look at the guitar itself as far as the sounds and whatnot. This is one of the new Fireflies. This is a Firefly FFDCS, Firefly double cut single pickup. I shot some video last night when I did take it out of the box, just to kind of give you initial fit and finish. Here's what it looks like coming right out of the box kind of looks. And we'll talk about those in a little bit. But first, how did we get here, right? Let's give you a little update. Why did I go and get this guitar in the first place? Well, for those of you who have seen some of my previous videos, my two previous videos was all about this guitar, the Firefly 388 semi-hollow body. I did an unboxing video of, we went over fit and finish, and then I covered some of the modifications that I did, new bridge, new pickups, new tuners. All of which were greatly needed on this guitar. With the upgrades that I did, this guitar is quickly turning into my favorite guitar. I absolutely love this thing. Love this guitar. So that's why I decided to check out one of the other Fireflies. I started looking online and, man, these things are really hit and miss. When they're on Amazon, if you're even thinking about it, you better hit that buy button, because these things go really, really quick. So in this line, they have a double cut and a single cut. So kind of a Les Paul Junior double cut and a Les Paul regular, like single cut kind of body style. I was looking at the single cuts, and frankly, I have some things like that already, namely this guy here, which is an awesome rock and roll machine. Get a chance to get one of these, do it, because they're not expensive and they're great guitars. So I decided to go for the double cut. Now, the single cut version of this guitar is about $120 delivered. The double cut version, for whatever reason, I guess because there's a little bit more tooling involved, is $130 delivered. But sprang for the extra $10 because I wanted the double cut. I've always wanted that type of body style anyway. So I went and got it. So let's have a quick look at it. So here she is. It is a very, very white guitar. If you went to Lowe's or Home Depot and said, I need a can of white paint, it's that white. It is pure, pure white. It is a gloss finish, so a white gloss. And you can see there is a little bit of a bevel cut there, which is kind of nice. Really good fit and finish on this guitar. In fact, it's such good fit and finish, there was really not a whole lot to talk about. I did take some video, and I'll show you that here in a second. But overall, great fit and finish on this guitar. Again, for the price range. The neck on this thing is, again, it is solid. It is a solid neck. Here's what I was fully expecting. I thought that 338 semi-hollow body, I thought that was like their introduction. Hey, we're gonna lose some money on these guitars, but we're gonna make a decent guitar and make people buy them up. And then I was fully expecting this guitar to be like that yellow Epiphone that's over my head. That guitar was a piece of crap. $99, you know, when those things came out, it is an absolute piece of crap. I had to do so much work to that guitar to get it playable, but I knew that going in. I bought it with that in mind. I said, I'm going to buy this guitar. I know it's going to be crap, but it's going to be a mod platform. So I bought it with that in mind. And it was. It didn't disappoint. It was a piece of crap that needed a lot of work. But that's what I expected from this guy. I expected to get this out of the box and go, oh, okay. Yeah, so they kind of hook you with the semi-hollow body, and then they ship you one of these and it's gonna be a piece of garbage. And it is not. So for this price range, this is the closest thing to a playable guitar that I have seen in this price range. $130, that's a pretty good budget level guitar. And this thing was playable right out of the box. So what do I consider playable? I don't mean I can fly up and down the fingerboard. That's not what I'm talking about. Because first of all, I can't fly up and down the fingerboard in the first place. But what do I consider playable? When I consider something playable out of the box, I'm thinking about a kid. I'm thinking about a first-time player, somebody who's just getting started. And what do I think is really important for a kid who's just starting out? Well, A, the thing has to be playable. You can't have an action so high that it can't be played, where, you know, hands, smaller, maybe not as strong hands, couldn't finger chords. So, and the fact that, number two, the intonation has to be right. And if the action is high, your intonation is never going to be right. But the intonation also needs to be right based on the hardware, based on the bridge, the way the nut is cut, and things like that. And the intonation on this guitar was for a wraparound bridge. We have to keep this in mind. For a wraparound bridge, the intonation on this guitar was fairly spot on. I mean, it was just a little bit on either side. It was acceptable. This could be perfect with a couple little changes, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. Good action, good intonation, and does it stay in tune? Which is mainly your tuners, the way your nut is cut. So far, I'm pretty impressed. Where that hollow body did not stay in tune worth a darn. I mentioned in previous videos, and you should go check those out, I spent more time tuning that guitar than I did playing it. That's not the case here. It's relatively stayed in tune. Now, it's drifting a little bit, but that's to be expected. That's why I wanted to get it in tension overnight. This morning, tuned up, staying in tune. So these tuners, they must have did a little bit of an upgrade on these tuners, because, and they do look a little different than the original tuners. What I need this tuner to be is accurate and stay in tune, and that's what they're doing. So kudos. So what were some of the other issues with the first Firefly, with the 338, that I had to deal with? Well, I changed the pickups on that because they were extremely microphonic and kind of ratty sounding. They didn't sound good. They had extremely low output too. One of the things I neglected to mention in the previous video for the hollow body is that the output of the new pickups was easily twice as loud, twice the output of the pickups I took out of there. Now, low output pickups aren't necessarily, it's not a bad thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Dan Electro lipstick pickups have an extremely low output, but they sound great. They're a great sounding pickup. They have a character. The pickups that were in this Firefly were low output, and they had a character, all right, but it wasn't a good one. So, but when we swapped those pickups out, that guitar just came to life. It's an amazing transformation. The GFS pickups that I put in there are rocking. They're just amazing, amazing pickups for the price. So we're gonna test this guy out. Is this pickup, this surface mount dog ear P90, is it microphonic? I don't know, we'll find out. All right guys, so you're gonna hear a little bit of buzz in the background, but I set this up just like I did the other test. I got a little bit of delay on the guitar. So we're gonna check, are these pickups microphonic? Or this pickup microphonic? Hey! Yeah, it is. Quite a bit, actually. So it is pretty microphonic. Hey! So let's check out this P90. Same setup, same amp, same delay. Let's see, is this pickup microphonic? Hey! A little bit. Not as much as that, but definitely a little bit. Hey! So we got a little bit of microphonicness from both P90s, but definitely a lot more from that guy. All right, guys, so we got a little bit of a high gain amp setting here. Let me turn the volume up on the guitar and see what happens. So you kind of hear that whistle there. So that's not a really even an extremely high gain setting. I'll let you know, I've played that Epiphone Les Paul through some pretty high gain settings, and it doesn't squeal. You know, you'll get the hiss because it's high gain. That's what high gain. That stuff's gonna happen. I don't really see this as a, well, this is kind of maybe showing a little bit of my bias, but I don't see this as a high gain guitar. When I look at this guitar, I think more just rock and roll crunch. You know, this is, you know, there are, you know, in the carpentry world, there are different types of hammers, right? There's finishing hammers, there's these little brass hammers you use to tap in these little brad nails, and then there are sludge hammers that you use to knock down walls. And that's, I think that's what this is. I think this is a sludge hammer. I think this is something you use to knock down walls and play rock and roll really loud, but not high gain, just crunch. So let's see. Let's see if I'm right about that. Some of the issues here with this bridge, because there are some. So if we take a look, and I got some pitch, see how it's kind of pitched up there? Now that by itself isn't necessarily a bad thing, and this is, that's fairly common for some wraparound bridges, especially when you have to kick it out so much to get the intonation right. Now, again, right out of the box, the intonation was fairly spot on this guitar. But look how much they had to kick it out to get it to be intonated. You know, if I was advising this company on how to make guitars, I would say, hey, why don't you drill those posts 3/16 of an inch back? Just move those posts 3/16 of an inch back. Then you wouldn't have to kick your bridge out so far to get it intonated. So why is that necessarily a bad thing? Well, it's a bad thing because if you also see, I have these posts buried. They are as deep as they can go. And while this action is good, it could be better. And the action on this was a little high out of the box for me. It wasn't necessarily bad, but it just was a little high. I lowered this. Now, these were already very low out of the box. I just turned them in as far as they would go. And now it's better. It's a little bit more than an eighth of an inch. I do get a little bit of fret buzz. So on just a couple of frets. Right there. A little bit of fret buzz there. A little bit of fret buzz there. So around the 7th fret and the 12th fret. Which means the fret ahead of that need to do a little work on. I don't know that I necessarily need to do an entire leveling on this entire guitar because it's just those two little spots. Just out of the box, just like my first impressions with that guitar right out of the box before I plugged it in, before I did anything, I knew those tuners had to go. I knew the bridge on the 338 had to go. It had a secondary vibration. There were some loose components inside that bridge that just made the whole bridge rattle when you played it. And it was unusable. That just that simple. It was unusable. But the only thing right out of the box with this guitar, when I look at it and say, okay, this needs to go, and I'm still on the fence, is this bridge. This bridge may need to go, but we're gonna find out. So with it kicked up like that, that raises the action. So even if I wanted to get this lower, since I'm buried here, since my posts are buried, the only way I'm gonna get any lower action on this guitar is this bridge has to be able to sit flat. It has to kick down. And the only way it's gonna kick down is it's gonna have to seat further into those posts. And the only way that's gonna happen is it's gonna need to be wider and it's gonna need to be adjustable. So I keep talking trash about this guitar, but let me break it down and show you what I did. One of the modifications I did on that was this bridge. So it is a wraparound bridge, but as you can see, much thicker, much beefier, and it sits flat because it sits all the way in the posts, and I can still intonate it because I have some movement. I can adjust things. It's a good bridge, not all that expensive, but yeah, that might be what I end up doing with that guy. So that's everything really wrong with this guitar. A couple of little paint things, this bridge. As far as like right out of the box, before we plug it in, this is what we see. The paint stuff, I don't really care. It's one of those things that you have to be right up on this to see it. And I don't want people getting that close to me anyway. So, but this bridge may also have to go. So now let's just talk about this guitar aesthetically, okay? Because one thing about the 338 is, man, that guitar's a looker. That's a good looking guitar, good looking finish. There is nothing wrong with how that guitar looks. So three things that I look for in a guitar. How does it sound? How does it play? How does it look? In that order. How does it sound is the first thing. What does it sound like? That is number one. I'll take a guitar that sounds good, that has a couple of little playing issues, over the opposite. A guitar that plays good but doesn't sound good. How does it sound? How does it play? How does it look? Looks are important, but not nearly as important as the other two. It's just like, that's the icing on the cake. That's the, oh, okay, cool. This guy, the finish, again, it's an awesome finish. There's nothing wrong with the finish on this guitar. What I wish is that it was, and I forget what they call it, but it's a thinner finish where they don't use a grain sealer. I'll find some pictures and put them up. But it has kind of more of a rustic look, if you will, where you can kind of see the grain through the paint. It's not see-through, it is still, you know, a solid color, but you can still kind of sense the grain there. I kind of wish this guitar had that finish. And you know what? I think that might be cheaper to do than this. I don't know, but it seems like, just from the looks of it, you're not having to seal the body as much, and it's, you know, cuts down a few steps. But really, that's finish-wise, that's the only thing I change about this guitar. But let's plug this guy in and see what it sounds like. Enough of me gabbing. Let's see what this thing sounds like. Fun. Yeah, it sounds good. On one of the guitar tracks, the guitar track that you'll hear primarily to the right, a little bit more of a fuzzy sound, I was getting a little bit of feedback on this still. It's not a really high gain, but you know that fuzz, and I was still getting a little squeal here and there when I wasn't playing. So I'm debating whether I'm gonna change out to pickup or not. The bridge, I'm still debating. We'll see. If there's a second video, you'll know why. All right, so let's put a bow on it. This is a good guitar. It's a really good guitar for the money. It's a really good guitar for a lot more money as well. This pickup, I just measured the pickup. It's about 8.5K output. It's not bad. It's not as weak as the pickups from the 338 semi-hollow body. So it's got some decent output, and it sounds good. It's a little microphonic. Maybe I'll just put up with that and know what it can and cannot do. If it gets to the point where I need this for something other than just rock and roll, then cool. Maybe I'll look into, or if I can find a good deal on a Dog Ear P90, I'll swap it out. But man, a lot of things about this guitar are just good. They're really good. Overall fit and finish, the way it's put together, the neck joint is solid. I mean, a really good neck joint. I was a little worried about that when I ordered it, but the finish is good. The fretboard is good. Needs a little bit of work on a couple of frets, but nothing major. The tuners on this are better than the tuners on the 338 semi-hollow body. The electronics in this, man, I opened up that cavity and was shocked. Full-size potentiometers, big old capacitor. I don't know if it's good or bad or otherwise, but it works and it does a good job. But yeah, decent electronics. Shielded cable coming from the pickup. 3-ply cover on the cavity. Not that makes a huge difference, but it's neat. So yeah, man, I'm unbelievably pleased with this guitar. I will tell you, the finish on the fretboard on this I think is better than the hollow body as well. Where that one, I really needed to oil it. It was dry as a bone and definitely needed some work. Not really the case on this one. This one's got a little bit of a shine to it, a little bit of a finish. It doesn't look dry. So the fretboard on this is good. So yeah, I'm telling you what, $130, you can't go wrong. You can't go wrong. And if it's not right for you, you donate it to some kid, donate it to some charity so some kid can get it, and it'll be a good first guitar for some kid. And if you're looking for a first guitar, this would be a good choice. Be sure you bring it to a local luthier. Spend the $35 to $50 to get a decent setup done on it. But it's worth it. So yeah, big fan, liking this guitar. Loving the 338 that I did the modifications on. I may buy the next Firefly that I see. From one of those thin line Telecaster type Fireflies become available, I may buy that as well, but we'll see. You'll know too, because I'll make a video about it. So good guitar, good solid rock and roll machine. That's all I got for you today. We'll see you later.
Hey folks, thanks for watching. The Tape Farm specializes in analog to digital transfers of many prosumer tape formats. From standard cassettes up to 16-channel multi-track recordings, we specialize in formats from manufacturers like Tascam, Fostex, Alesis, and others. So if you have some old tapes in your closet that you'd like to get converted to digital files that can be loaded into your DAW of choice to either relive or remix the past, send them on to us. You can check us out at thetapefarm.com.